I thought you would want to come back. Do you remember last time I was telling you all about Thimble? Well, for those of you that don't know who I am Hazelberry Hawthorne. I am a woodland fairy and a storyteller. And I have been telling you all about the story of Thimble Cotton Flute, who is betrothed to the most unfortunate knave and is deeply unhappy about it. Now, we left her in quite a quandary last time, so let us delve in and see what's going on with her. Thimble was still disgruntled after her confrontation with Till at the Pink Lakes, and was by all accounts furious at his behaviour, and this only further cemented her belief and unhappiness at the prospect of becoming his fairy wife. "Goodness!" exclaimed Thimble to herself. "This is going to take some serious magical thinking." And she pulled out Twig, her faithful wand, and with one tap, one blink, and one blast of magic, she pointed the wand at her face, which immediately made her lips glisten, her eyes sparkle, and her cheeks glow. "Well," she said out loud, producing a mirror to inspect her reflection, "if I have to think of a plan, it would be rude not to look my very, very best." And with that, she hovered off towards the apple orchards, where she hoped to find her father, Lord Flute, who liked to think there and may have some much-needed answers. Making sure she flew over the lakes twice to inspect her perfect reflection. The apple orchard sat behind Flute Manor, the beautiful house and home of Thimble and her parents, Lord and Lady Flute. It was sandwiched between a neatly sown garden with an array of flowering shrubs and beautiful strawberry woods, a place laden with wild berries all year round. The couple were most proud of their daughter, although had hoped that she might smarten herself up and adopt a more fairy-like outlook on life. For there was not actually that much fairy-like about the way Thimble dressed. She loved her rustic torn skirts and leather waistcoats, and wasn't at all interested in her mother's love of dressmaking, or indeed anything pink and frilly. But despite not understanding their daughter's wayward outlook, or from time to time her choice in friends. In particular, a pixie whom I shall introduce you to shortly. Lord and Lady Flute loved Thimble very much. Lord Flute had been a respected member of the Royal Fairy Council and was now retired, spending his time in the apple orchard's dense foliage, thinking deeply about fairy lore and tradition, and was by all accounts a very deep thinker indeed. Perhaps I should have told you, this particular apple orchard was a thinking apple orchard, and every single juicy apple had a thought in every bite. But you have to be very careful with thoughts. They can be tricky things to contain sometimes, and they can send you all over the place trying to get back to where you began. Indeed. Now, where was I? Ah, yes. All the Applebees who lived there had grown accustomed to hearing his mutterings and procrastinations, which would grow louder and louder as the day went on. Thimble hovered over the trees for a while, admiring the beehives which hung from the top branches. The bees buzzed around her, as if to say hello, just as she spied her father sat under one of his favourite trees. Lord Flute was sitting in his long green gown and brown peaked hat, which is what he always wore, and he hadn't noticed Thimble's arrival at all. "Are you thinking out loud again, Father? Remember what happened the last time you thought a bit too loudly?" said Thimble, making poor Lord Flute jump so high he nearly hit his head on an overhanging branch.
"Well, oh dear,
was about all he could manage to get out. Oh, Father! Have you been eating lots of apples again? Inquired Thimble crossly. Clearly Lord Flute had helped himself to quite a few of the delicious fruit and was deliriously happy in his thoughts. You had better not let Mother see you like this, exclaimed Thimble. Remember what happened when she was having tea with Miss Skinnythorn, the schoolmistress, and you managed to tell her exactly what you thought on her strict and somewhat snooty ideas, continued Thimble.
Yes, I do, said Lord Flute.
Something about her pompous ideas and old-fashioned views, continued Thimble with a smile on her face.
Well, replied Lord Flute with a little more thought. Perhaps I should have left that bit out. Oh dear.
Lord Flute had certainly not put himself in Lady Flute's good books, and was banned from his beloved orchard and made to supply free colouring spells for the school for an entire year. Yes, a year. And in fairy timekeeping, that was a very long time indeed. Well, Father, there is a very pressing matter which I must discuss with you.
Lord Flute tried to focus. He had learnt that Thimble never just wanted to talk, and he would probably not like what he was going to hear.
He remembered the time Thimble had once asked him to convince Lady Flute that she didn't need to go to the grand fairy ball, which Lady Flute herself took pride in organising once every third moon in Saturn. Thimble said her studies were far more important than grand balls, and Lord Flute had to agree on that occasion. And despite her mother's disappointment in not seeing her in her first fairy ball gown, Lady Flute had reluctantly agreed. However, Thimble had also forgotten that part of her study plan would involve levitating off to the pixie realm for a rather important party to raise a toast to her friend Periwinkle's 200th birthday. Oh dear. Unfortunately, fairies couldn't really drink or eat the same things as more pixies, who had a very hearty appetite for lots of fun. And so after finishing 3 goblets of Periwinkle's floral wine and cherry cake, all washed down with at least 2 mugs of parchment beer. Oh dear! Thimble was by all accounts not quite herself. Now I have to say at this point, this is very bad behaviour indeed. For anyone, but for a fairy. Oh, it's not funny. Anyway, where was I? Thimble and Periwinkle, once realising that it wasn't big or clever, decided Thimble should really try and make her way home with haste. They then spent a good hour trying to remember which strip of time she had levitated through, where she was going when she got there, and what moon of the month it was, all through fits of giggles and hearty backslaps. Dear, dear, dear! Eventually, Thimble managed to navigate her way back to the valley, but misjudged her landing, ending up in a heap in the middle of the dance floor of her mother's grand ball. Everyone was shocked to see the daughter of Lady Flute that she had just been so eloquently talking about, looking so dishevelled in a heap on the floor. You could have heard a pin drop from the apple orchards to the flatlands in the north. Thimble pulled herself off the floor and curtsied. Oh, goodness! She exclaimed and vomited all over her feet. Now, with all this in mind, poor Lord Flute braced himself. You see, Father, after great thought and deliberation, I keep coming to the same conclusion. And that is, Tilano Toil is not the fairy I could ever imagine marrying. In fact, hadn't actually imagined marrying at all just yet. So what I'm saying is this whole situation must be some kind of mistake. I do not want to marry and be confined to the royal household. There are too many moons and seas to discover before I do such a thing. And with that, she waited a few moments for Lord Flute to reply, who was now uncomfortably quiet, especially considering how many apples he'd just eaten.
Thimble, he said, clearing his throat. As your father, I have a duty to you that is undeniable. But I also have an obligation to this valley, and its ex-councillor, not to mention friend to the Queen. I have to respect the wishes of the royal household that you do indeed marry Till. Ooh. Like it or not, he said as sternly as he could. By now, the music masters are composing your wedding score. The flowers have been ordered to grow their very best colours, and your mother has designed, seamed and ironed the material for your dress. Your timing is very poor, young fairy. I'm afraid this time, Thimble, it's out of my hands.
Oh dear. Thimble had not anticipated her father wouldn't be able to come up with some kind of solution and buried her head in her hands. She knew that life in the royal household would mean no magic spells, no levitating to see Periwinkle, and no fun at all. Lord Flute, who had never liked Thimble looking sad, decided to at least try and find a solution. He took an extra large bite from the biggest apple he could find and waited until the thoughts did their magic.
You will have to ask the Queen herself. If you are unhappy, go and tell her why and ask her to reconsider.
Thimble's face dropped. Queen Lilybell the Red was not an easy fairy to get to talk to, or easy to talk to when you got there. In fact, by all accounts, she was ever so slightly, how shall I say, unpredictable. But it was the only advice Thimble had. Goodness, exclaimed Thimble. This is going to be much harder than I'd first imagined. And she picked an apple from a nearby branch and vanished in Elvetian. Elvetian was used by the ancient elves over 3 millennium moons ago. And they only ever used it when they went to war. Oh, goodness. Those are the calling birds. I shall have to go. But I know you shall want to come back and hear what happens to Thimble next. Until then, take care. And remember, don't stop believing, especially in you.